Hello, my dear friends. Today, in the Indian Writing in English section, that too, the poetry section, the poet we have taken up for today is Henry Louis Vivian Derozio. He was an Anglo-Indian of origin, and the poem we have taken up today is a sonnet. So, first, let's begin with Derozio's introduction.
Henry Louis Vivian Derozio, 18th April 1809 to 26th December 1831. He was an Indian poet of Portuguese origin and assistant headmaster of Hindu College, Kolkata. Actually, he was an Anglo-Indian in origin. He was a radical thinker of his time and one of the first Indian educators to disseminate Western learning and science among the young men of Bengal. Long after his death, that was by cholera, his legacy lived on among his former students, who came to be known as Young Bengal, and many of whom became prominent in social reform, law and journalism. His one of the most admired poems is Harp of India, which is written in the Petrarchan or the Italian sonnet model. Today, the poem we have with us is titled Poetry, and it is also a sonnet, that is a 14-lined poetry, but this sonnet is written in the Shakespearean format or the English sonnet format. That's why the rhyme scheme which it follows is AB, AB, CD, CD, EF, EF, and G, G. That is, it is divided into three stanzas of four lines each, and the last two lines are the rhyming couplet. So we start with the poem. Sweet madness, when the youthful brain is seized with that delicious frenzy which it loves, it raving reels to very rapture pleased, and then through all creation wildly roves. So first these four lines we'll take up. What does it mean? Sweet madness. You see? The poet is starting with an antithesis. The madness, but the madness which is sweet. And then he went on to say that the youthful brain is full of, is seized with delicious frenzy, which it loves. Means actually he's talking about a turmoil which is going in the brain, which is going inside the mind of the poet. Actually it is full of so many thoughts. The thoughts which it loves. The thoughts which he is going to pen down, which he is going to jot down in the form of a poetry. So he is talking about the whole process, how a poetry is formed. And that is formed obviously by various moods. The moods which is of madness but sweet, which is of frenzy but it is delicious. So he is having two opposites together, two antitheses together. The frenzy which is delicious, the madness which is sweet. And it is like a reel, a thread of the imagination, the raving reels, to very rapture pleased. Again an antithesis, the rapture, but it is a pleasing rapture. So actually he is talking about all the emotional turmoil person goes, or the turmoil which goes inside the mind of a person before a poetry is born. And then through all creation, wildly roves, and the mind moves towards all the components of nature, towards everything that is in our creation, towards everything that is all around us, and takes or seeks inspiration from the things around us. So what are the things which are around us? Now in the deep recesses of the sea, and now to the highest Himalaya it mounts. So the mind of the poet can go deep down inside the sea to the fathoms of the sea, and it can rise up or mount up to the highest of the Himalayas.
It's like the Hindi poetry which says, Jahan na pahunche Ravi, wahan pahunche Kavi. So a poet's imagination can build towers out of sheer imagination. Now by the fragrant shores of Araby or classic Greek or sweet Italia's founts. So the mind can move or roam about anywhere freely. It can rise up the mountains, it can go down the seas, it can reach up the shores of the Arabian seas, it can go to the Greek lands, it can go to the fountains of Italy. So it can be anywhere, it can roam about anywhere to any creation of this world. It can move through the wilderness of ruins or through her wilderness of ruins, now grazing on beauty's lips, valor's brow, or rivaling the nightingale and dove in pouring forth its melody of love. So the imagination can have no limits. It can have no boundaries or foundations. It can move up to the ruins of the Italian monuments. It can roam about in the wilderness. It can be compared to the beauty, or it can be compared to the valor. The valor on the brow or the beauty on the lips. It can be equivalent to the nightingale and the dove, which are singing birds. So you see, the melody of nightingale or the melody of dove is so beautiful. It's melodious. It is a melody of love. It pours forth love. But it can rival them. The poetry of the poet, the poetry, the creation of an artist can rival the melodies of nightingale and dove too. And the last two lines are giving to the gale in strains of fire, immortal harpings like a seraph's lyre. So how is the poetry? The poetry is like the harping. Harping is the continuous music which is created by the playing of a harp. What is a harp? Harp is a musical instrument. So just like a harp which can create immortal music, just like a seraph. Seraph is a celestial body. It is like an angel. So just like a seraph which plays upon a lyre. Lyre is again a musical instrument. So when the seraph plays a lyre, a celestial, a heavenly music is created. Or when a harp is played, the immortal music which is created. All these musics, the music of nightingale, the music of dove, all these beautiful birds which the music they create, all can be compared to the poetry created by a poet. So this is the beauty of poetry which the poet is talking about, which Derozio is talking about. How poetry is created? It is created out of frenzy which is delicious, out of madness which is sweet, out of rapture which is pleased. And through all these emotions bounded together, it becomes so pleasing that it pleases even more than the seraph's lyre. So that is all about this poem.